excited to share their summer camp experience with you and lead in worship today. So I hope that you are excited too and can bring some energy with us. And there's a part in this song that we're going to do. We've done it before. And it goes, "You called my name." And then it goes, "And I ran out of that grave." Yeah, I want y'all to yell it. So we're going to practice. "You called my name." Have fun. Stand with us as we worship.
Sorry, I got unwired there for a second. All right, thank you for coming to worship with us this morning at Salem Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here this morning. If you are visiting with us, this is not our normal setup. So don't worry. Come back next week and hear the real pastor. But we are glad that you are here, because this is a very special time for us, because this is when we get to share with you the experience that we all had at summer camp this year. So that's what these songs are. That's what we'll be talking about later. We'll have some testimonies, a video, some different things, and we just want you to hear and maybe experience a little bit of what we got to experience just a couple of weeks ago. So as we continue this time of worship, would you bow your heads and pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we love you so very much, Lord. I thank you that that you died for us. I thank you that when you enter our lives, things change, God. You mend broken things. And there may be some broken people here this morning. So God, I ask you to help them to see that they can walk out of that grave into your glorious day. I thank you for what you've done for us, Lord. We love you this morning, and we want to worship you together and in spirit and in truth. And we ask you to just be with us, help us to just experience a little bit of what it will be like on that glorious day. And we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
I was lost, I was asleep at the wheel, I was drifting off, my heart was failing, my heart was failing, in the dark, heard a song, it was the sweetest sound that I've ever heard, and my soul went sailing, yeah, my soul went sailing.
Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from, Cotton Eye Joe? But I hadn't been for Cotton Eye Joe. I've been married a long time ago. Where did you
go? Along with the horses, I'm gonna cross over Jordan. I'm waking up. I can feel my heart beating and breath in my lungs. It's like a
students that are going to come forward for some interview time and just kind of share with you some things about camp. And so I'm going to hand that microphone to Joseph there. And I'm going to sneak right behind you, grab my Bible here. Yeah, all those stools are rated at 1,000 pounds. We had a really wonderful year at camp. Just to share with you, we had about three or four students who during the week came forward and said, I don't know what God's wanting to do in my life, but whatever it is, I want him to do it. And we had one young man come forward and say, I don't think I've been going in the right direction, and I want to rededicate my life to Christ. So we had a good time. So I've asked these four to come up, and I'm just going to ask them some questions and then let them share with you a little bit about their experience with Fuge camps and this year in particular. So my first question to you guys is, how many Fuge camps have each of you attended? How many times have y'all been to Fuge camp?
I've been to Fuge four times.
I've been to Fuge four times.
Oh, wow. Four times.
I've been to Fuge two times.
All right. So we've got some veterans here, so you can believe what they say. Okay. What is your favorite thing about camp? And I'm going to try to stand back because I know I'm blocking some folks. What's your favorite thing about camp?
There's so much, but if I had to narrow it down, I guess it would be that you're around so many people that share the same faith as you, and it's like you get, whenever there's a life change or God's working in someone's life, you get to experience it with them, and it's really cool.
Yeah.
There's so many amazing things about camp, and like I cannot describe, like I love it all, but probably the songs. I just have learned so many songs that have impacted like my life, and like I just love the worship. That's my favorite part.
Mine probably would be morning celebration, because even though it's maybe 7:30, 8 o'clock, and we've had 6 hours of sleep, maybe five, maybe less, that they are, it's loud. It's really loud. Everybody is jumping around, and it just wakes you up and gets you ready for the day to go throughout and Bible study. It's really good. Morning celebration is.
Mine would have to be the worship, because God blessed me with the voice, and I want to use it.
Awesome, awesome. I've enjoyed the worship too. As a matter of fact, probably about, missing that, about 90% of the songs that the students do either came from Strength to Stand or a camp, I'm pretty sure. Okay, now, what is one of your best memories from camp? And it doesn't even have to be this year. Any camp you've been to, like, what would you say, this will stick with me, this one memory?
The one thing that happened, it was this year. It was the last full day that we were there. And Drew couldn't get to the room. And he'll probably tell you why he wasn't in the room. But we were we were staying up late waiting for him to get back. And it was a bunch of high school dudes in one room. So that's like a recipe for destruction. But we were joking around waiting for him to get back. And Alan Thompson was in our room with us. He kept telling a bunch of jokes, and it was a hilarious time, and I loved it.
The extra high school boy.
Probably one thing that happened this year was that it rained on us the entire day. I'm talking rained on us. Soaking wet the entire day. And, I mean, we're up in the mountains, so it's humid and it's hot, and also we got lost, and it rained.
Mine would be this year, the very first day we got there, so we've never been to this camp, so we had no clue where we were going anywhere. And the rec field was probably like half a mile up the hill. And me and I think it was all of us four and Carly Thompson and some, I think maybe somebody else, I don't know. We were trying to find it, and we went the absolute opposite direction that we were supposed to go. And we went up this huge hill, and we got to like some kind of tower. We were not where we were supposed to be. And so then we had to turn around and go back, and then we just gave up and look for it the next day.
Parents, we knew where they were the whole time.
My reason, which was this year also, and why I wasn't at the room, is because I decided to fight a sign and lost. And I have a mark that I'll remember. So.
Yeah. You'll remember those staples too, I bet. Okay, let's see. What did you guys get from your Bible study this year? And just a reminder, our theme for this year was revival generation. So there were a lot of themes of revival in a lot of the things that they did. But, of course, there's still a lot of other things that we went over as well. So you guys share something that kind of stuck with you from Bible study this year.
One thing that was really with me was my Bible study leader talked about how prayer is our way not only to ask God for things, but the way our way to talk to God. And it's very important as Christians to pray because we're talking to our Creator. It brings us closer to Him. So I was able to think, well, I wasn't able to, but it, the more he talked about it, the more it made me think that maybe I need to be praying more. And that was one thing that stuck with me.
One of the things that stuck out to me was when you walk in your Bible study, there's a bunch of posters on the wall, and one of the posters was a diagram, and it has, so it's like a circle, and then after that it's another circle, but there's like a crack in it, and that represents the sin. So God made the world, and then we sinned, and then there's an arrow pointing down, and that represents God sending Jesus to earth as a man. And then the next one was a cross, and that shows how Jesus died for us, for our sins. And the next is like a oval, which is like a upside down U, and that's the tomb that Jesus rose on the third day. And then another one is an arrow pointing up, and that's Jesus going back to heaven. And then there's an arrow coming down, which represents Jesus coming back one day. And that just stuck out to me because that's one way that you can share, so like just share the word, and that just stuck out to me.
That was the whole gospel. That sums the whole thing up right there.
Mine is going off what Joseph said, prayer, because that's what one of the main things we talked about. And we had a, I don't know what it's called. It was from the book Acts, and you like each letter had a word with it. And the first one was adoration. Like that's, and you would need to praise him first. And then C is confession and confessing your sins and saying that you're sorry for what you've done. And then the next one is thanksgiving and thanking him for anything good that's happened today, or even if it's a bad day, the only thing you can thank him for is him dying on the cross for you. Then the last one was supplication, and you don't want to start your prayer off like, God, I need this. Please give me this. You want to pray for others more than you're praying. I mean, it's more mature, I guess you'd say, for you to be praying more for others than you are praying for yourself. And that's just what we, because we talk about it every day in Bible study, that the Acts thing, and it just stuck with me. I wrote it down, and I try to use that every day when I'm praying.
What stuck with me was how our revival has started. It could start with anyone from my age, younger to older. And I think that stuck with me just because it's something that would be amazing to see in our generation. So
piggybacking off his answer there, what do you think it would take for your generation to be or become a revival generation?
I think that it would take a lot of people who call themselves Christians but aren't really following God to realize that they have to not necessarily do more, but they have to understand what it takes to really follow Jesus. And people need to allow God to move in their lives so that we can help others realize that they need Jesus.
I would just say for one way that we can share is by giving our testimonies and just helping others, like pointing the way to God. Like if you have a friend that doesn't like know anything, you can just be like, hey, you want to come to church for the day, just any way that you can share the gospel to them.
I think, honestly, a good amount of things for our generation, because it's kind of going downhill. But I think prayer, because this we need a lot right now. And like Carly said, for us to go out and share it with other people and not just think that we can do it by ourselves. We need other people to come with us and come to Christ and help us get the revival that we need, because you can't do it alone and you need other people to do it with you.
Like many people at the camp said, the reason why our generation isn't coming to Christ is because they're not living in it daily. So exposing it to them daily would greatly improve it.
Yes, excellent. Okay, last question. I want you to say your name, because we forgot to do that at the beginning. You don't know who these people are. Say your name, and then answer this question. What would you say to a young person who has not gotten to go to camp? What would you say to encourage them to go to camp?
My name is Joseph Kirk, and I would say that anyone that you ask that's been there could tell you that it changes your life in a way that you can't get anywhere else, because you're being exposed to the gospel and worship and God in general just every day, and it really allows God to change your life and move in you so that you can realize what you've been missing or what you've been needing to rekindle.
My name is Carly Denton, but the youth calls me D.
Here we go.
I would just say go. It's amazing. You meet so many new people. You get closer to God, and you just learn so many different things that, like, it has changed my life. Like, Fuge Camps is probably the best part of summer, of the year that, like, it's just awesome. Like, you just got to go.
My name's Ashton Harden, and I would just say do it. You're going to regret it if you don't go, because it's life-changing. After I got back home, I felt the need to be in my Bible more, and I'm in it every night, and I want to do that constantly, because I feel like it just gives me comfort, and that's what you get from going to Fuge, is comfort and knowing that God's with you and he'll never leave you. And every year, it gets even better. Like this year, even though we went to somewhere new, I felt the same thing, and it's just go. You need to go.
My name is Drew Gordon, and I would say that if this camp could go longer throughout the year, everybody should go. So.
I like it. We'll just take the whole church. I think y'all enjoy it. The food's good. The beds are a little hard, but the food's good. Okay, thank you guys. I am so proud of these students. Y'all may take a seat up here. Thank you. I couldn't be prouder of these students. Even though one of them's mine, I'll let you figure out which one that is. So to close, I'm going to preach a couple hours. I'm just kidding. I don't have a sermon of my own this morning. What I want to do is just share a little bit with you. We had a pastor, Travis Agnew, who was from South Carolina, and he was our camp pastor this year. And I just want to share with you a scripture that he opened with and some points that he made out of that scripture, and then the challenge that he gave to our students and adults. I'll just tell you, as a leader, when you go to camp, the worship services are wonderful, and the students get a lot out of it, but we're there too. As a matter of fact, we even have our own adult Bible study in the mornings when they go have theirs. So camp is for us as well. So that's why I want to share this with you, because I don't think this needs to stay at camp. We need to bring it home. If we're going to have a revival generation, we're going to have that because we start a revival in our hearts, right? So part of that is asking that question, what does your generation need to have revival in our hearts. And so he started out sharing from Psalm 85. Psalm 85. And I just want to share with you the points that he drew out of this, because I think it's very impactful when we're thinking about revival in our hearts, okay? Psalm 85. I'll give you just a second, and then I'm going to read some verses and share with you. All right, this is what God's Word says. We're going to start in verse 1. And it says, Lord, you have been favorable to your land. You have brought back the captivity of Jacob. You have forgiven the iniquity of your people. You have covered all their sins. Selah, you have taken away all your wrath, and you have turned from the fierceness of your anger. And so the first point that Travis made to our students was, did you hear all of that forgiveness and all these things that he says? He says, well, what I want you to think about is nobody forced God to forgive you. Nobody was forcing. Nobody can make God forgive you. He did that because he loves you, right? So when we go to God in forgiveness and we pray, you know, God, will you forgive me? And he does that. He's not doing that because you're making him do that, or you did some, you know, fancy recipe that you know, just made him do something. He was doing that because he loves you, right? And when you obey and you go to him in obedience, he says, I want to forgive you, and he does, right? He pushes away his anger. He forgives our iniquity like it's wiped away. And that's what he wants to do for us this morning, and nobody is forcing him to forgive us. Now, verse 4, restore us, O God, of our salvation, and cause your anger toward us to cease. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger to all generations? Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Show us your mercy, Lord, and grant us your salvation. Now, the point that he made here, and this is probably one of the points that stuck the most with me from camp, and this is the point. The fact that I can have a relationship with Christ, you can have a relationship with Christ, and yet still move away and be away from God. You can be in a relationship with God at one day and then grow distant from him the next. And I don't want to stress anybody out or worry, but students, we've been gone from camp, what, 2 weeks or so? Maybe three, 2 weeks? That's already long enough that if we're not following after Christ, that's long enough for us to go right back to sleep. We could be alive in Christ at camp on Friday when we leave there, and we could be asleep away from Christ today. Right? Okay, let's keep reading. Verse 8, I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people and to his saints. But let them not turn back to folly. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Do not turn back from folly. This is the point where Travis was telling us that if we're going to have revival, it's going to happen because we don't fall back. We continue to relentlessly obey God. We say, I'm turning from that, and I'm going to follow after him. I'm going to know his word. I'm going to read his word. I'm going to be in his word. I'm going to be close to him, and I'm going to follow him. And that has to be a daily thing. That's not a Sunday thing. That's not a when I feel like it thing. That's where we got to stay. That's got to be our normal mode, right? That's got to be what we're going to do. We're going to say, my life is God's on Sunday, and it's also God's on Monday through Saturday as well. Right? That's how revival starts. Now, here's the next part. Verse 10. Mercy and truth met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. Mercy and truth have met together, and righteousness and peace have kissed. And here's what that is. mercy and truth represent the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel. The truth about who we are and what we've done as sinners, but the mercy of God that says, I love you enough to send my son to die for you, right? And so if we're going to have that revival where we go back to Christ and then we take the light of Jesus out to the world, we have to take the gospel to the world, but we have to take it in the right way. Mercy and truth have to meet together. In other words, too many churches today fall to one side or the other of the gospel. They're either it's all mercy and we don't need to tell any truth, we just need to talk about how merciful God is, right? Or there's the other side that's like, it's just this and this truth and you need to straighten up and God hates you and God hates sin. But see, the gospel is God hates sin and we have to repent. But we have the mercy of God that gives us every breath of our lives to repent. Both of those things are the gospel. And just one of them by themselves is not the gospel. It's not just mercy, but it's not just truth. It's mercy and truth have met together. That's what Jesus does for us. And last, we need to remove the obstacles that are keeping us from following Christ, right? Verse 11, truth shall spring out of the earth and righteousness shall look down from heaven. Yes, the Lord will give what is good and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him and shall make his footsteps our pathway, right? His footsteps need to be our pathway. So if we're looking for other things, if we're looking for other pathways, we're not going to be following into revival. We're not going to be following into God's will. We're not going to be following into the fullness of his grace and his love and his mercy. And so many times the world is going to put things in our pathway to try to stop us from going forward, right? And here's the bad thing. We say, oh, you know, that's somebody else. Oh, look at them. Look how they failed. And then we get to that stumbling block and we realize the devil knows exactly which ones to put in my path, right? Because I could stand up here and talk about how I don't deal with alcohol and I don't deal with this and I don't deal with that. But let me tell you something. Devil knows exactly what I do deal with. And he knows exactly what you deal with. And he's not going to tempt you with what gets me. He's going to tempt you with what gets you. And so you're going to have to stay with Christ and keep your eyes on Christ and say, that's an obstacle. That's not the path that Jesus is going on. That's wrong. Right? I can't do that for you. You have to do that. You've got to remove those things. You've got to say, you know what, Jesus, I'm going to get up today and your footsteps are going to be my pathway. Right? It's like the little kid where I lived, where I grew up was a little different than West Tennessee. We used to get snows that when you were about 4 or 5 were up to about your neck, you know, that kind of thing. And so when you would go outside, you normally didn't go outside unless you had an adult. And you would, you know, dad or whoever would be walking along and they'd be making big footprints in the snow and making a little path. And then you're going right in those footsteps behind them because you can't even get out of that path, right? That's what we need to be, following Christ, like a little kid in the snow following daddy's footprints, because that's the only way he can get where he needs to go, right? That's what Jesus wants to be for us, that father who's walking that path in front of us. And so when we think about these things for Revival Generation, the fact that God loves us and is merciful to us, and he forgives us because he wants to forgive us, right? He loves us. When we repent, he says he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. And then remembering the fact that we can back away. We can have that relationship and then move off into another direction, right? And we need to follow after him and make sure his footsteps are our pathway. And so this was the challenge, and this is the challenge I'm going to give you as we get ready for an invitation time. But I want you to just think about these things, because everybody in this room, when we talk about Revival Generation, this isn't something that is somewhere else and God's waiting to give it to us. It's either here or it's not. And this is how we know where we are in relation to revival. This is how we'll know if our church is ready to go out and set Gibson County on fire. If we're in the place that we should be, and here's some places where you are going to be in relation to revival in your heart, okay? Here's number one. The first place you're going to be in relation to revival is you're going to be alive. You're going to have a relationship that is vibrant and growing in your Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, and you're following hard after Him. And when we have people that are doing that, lives start changing. People start showing up to church because somebody told them about the gospel and who Jesus Christ is, right? Lives start changing. Families start changing, right? And when we are in that place, revival starts, right? It would just take a few sparks to set this whole world on fire for Jesus Christ. We need to be in that place, right? But here's the problem. Just like we saw in that psalm, the next place you can be is asleep. And all it takes is us for take our eyes off that path and start looking at that obstacle that looks so good, right? And it looks like that's the way I should go, and I really want that, right? Because our world tells us it's all about what you want and what you think you need and what you think you are, and not about who the Creator who loves you and lovingly created you and made you to be. And they push off to the side for those obstacles. And all of a sudden, a person who was following Jesus Christ is all of a sudden asleep. And what do we need? We need to wake up. We need to get back in God's Word. We need to get back in that prayer. We need to get back on that path and say, I'm following you. I'm sorry. Forgive me. I want to follow you, right? And He says He loves us so much that that's what He's in the business of doing. Here's the next place. Maybe you're antagonistic against this. Maybe you hear that Jesus stuff and you're like, ah, that's not for me. You know, that's crazy stuff. But maybe, just maybe this morning, there's something in your heart where you're going, you know what? That sounds like, that's got the ring of truth in it. I think I've seen some of that in my life. Maybe that's where you are this morning, and you need to find that path you've never been on and realize that that's where real life is. When you're following hard after Jesus Christ, you're following after the one who made you, who's pointing you in the direction of what He made you to do. That's when you're going to have real peace and real life and be where you really need to be. And last is probably the scariest group that you might be in today. That's the apathetic group. And here's the sad thing is, because it might be this case in this room, and I'll just about guarantee you it was the case at camp when Travis was telling us this. I guarantee you there were people in there that were apathetic. And here's why I say this was the scariest group you can be in, because they probably sat through that day and maybe even sit in here through this today, and they don't hear a word I'm saying. And they're going to walk out of here, and nothing is going to happen in their life. But they'll put their check mark on, I went to church, and that's it. That's a scary place to be, because you don't even realize the Savior has walked off, and you're not even around. You don't want to be there, especially if you were a believer who was following, right? And now you just don't care. The way we talked about it in our youth group is like somebody in that group, their salvation experience is what we used to call fire insurance. They just hope they're not going to go to hell, and that's all they need from Jesus. I'll do my life my way, and you just give me my fire insurance, and we'll be good. Thanks, Jesus. Right? Please don't be in that group this morning. If you're in any of those other groups besides alive, would you just take a look at your heart this morning? And I'm not going to call you out. And I can tell you, I've been in some of these groups many times. Oh, you're a preacher. You don't do it. Yes, preachers go to sleep just like everybody else. I'll just tell you. Because all it takes, if this doesn't say, oh, this is not for preachers. Preachers have a different path. It's the same thing. God knows exactly what we deal with. And if we stop doing what we're supposed to do, we fall right asleep with everybody else. I think we have some denominations in our world who their leaders have fallen asleep. I hope that doesn't happen to us, right? But just take an honest look into your heart. Where are you? I'm going to ask our students to come up, and we're going to sing another song. And